Hi, my name is Ryan Salerno. I'm a cloud security specialist at Microsoft. And what I have today, I'm going to share a little bit about some of the top trends and concerns we're seeing from the cloud security landscape, and then walk through some of the ways where Defender for Cloud can be leveraged to stay ahead of or overcome some of those challenges. So there's lots of statistics on the screen, but really they all kind of in one way or another go back to the rate at which organizations have adopted and are continuing to adopt cloud native services. So there's a slide or a statistic I really like to reference that's actually not on the slide, but it comes to us from Gartner, and it's that back in 2021, 30% of new applications were built using cloud native services. They're projecting by the end of this year in 2025 that that number is going to be 95% of applications, or 19 of every 20. So ultimately, cloud native applications are the way forward. Most organizations are starting to embrace them in one way or another, whether that's leveraging things like microservices, containers, even generative AI. And while these technologies have really allowed organizations to scale tremendously well, and it's allowed developers to develop their code more efficiently than ever, from a security perspective, it's really caused our attack surfaces to change and really explode really, really rapidly. So a lot of these different concerns that we're seeing today are a result of that rapid expansion of the attack surface. One of the statistics on this slide that really jumps out to me the most is that 68% of organizations' primary concerns are inadequate visibility and monitoring across multi-cloud and hybrid environments. So if we think of something like the NIST cybersecurity framework, we understand that the first fundamental step of securing our environment is actually just having visibility into it. It's being able to identify where all of our assets are. After all, how can you protect what you don't know? So the fact that 68% of organizations' primary concern is that they're missing that fundamental first step of visibility, combined with how quickly and rapidly their attack surfaces are changing, overall, it's a really bad mix. This is unfortunately made even worse by the fact that we know that 64% of organizations have a shortage of both proactive and reactive cloud security staff. So this is something that's unfortunately going to tip the favor in the adversaries for the adversaries even more. And organizations are really forced to be as efficient as possible with the staff and the resources that they have. And even more importantly, the technology and the platforms that those resources are using have to be able to really help those analysts prioritize risk as much as possible and prioritize those threats in their environment. At the end of the day, there simply aren't enough resources to triage every single alert and to mitigate every single risk. So we really need to be prioritizing those that are the most critical in our environment. And that's exactly how I can use Defender for Cloud. So Defender for Cloud is a CNAPP, or a cloud native application protection platform. That is a Gartner defined term that really describes this type of end-to-end security platform for securing cloud native applications. Not only does Defender for Cloud help me across that application lifecycle from the point that the application is being developed as code all the way to when it's actually running in my production environment, but it also helps me secure my environment throughout that NIST cybersecurity framework as well. So what I mean by that is that not only can Defender for Cloud help me take proactive steps to reduce risk in my environment and harden it against threats, but it can also actually help us reactively respond and secure our environments as well. So how can we actually detect and respond to suspicious or even malicious runtime activities in our environment? So overall, I can use Defender for Cloud for both of those areas as we combine posture management, threat workload protection, and DevOps security all into one platform. So now what I'd like to do is walk through two technical demos showing both how we can use Defender for Cloud for a posture management proactive security, as well as how we can use it to reactively secure our environments by detecting threats. So starting with posture management and understanding how we can take proactive steps to harden our environment, let's keep with that first fundamental step of actually securing our environment and seeing what our inventory actually looks like. So you can see as I go through my environment here, I have over 11,000 different cloud resources. Many of those are Azure, although I do have a presence in AWS and GCP as well. And as you see in throughout this page, I have all of my different resources, whether those are virtual machines, Kubernetes pods, all listed out here. And on the right, you see the different recommendations that are applied to all of these different resources. So if I want to start proactively securing this resource and taking steps to mitigate the risk on it, I should be paying attention to these recommendations. Within Defender for Cloud, a recommendation is essentially an instance where it has identified some type of risk in your environment. That could be something like a misconfiguration, could be a vulnerability, it could be something like not following best practices for deployment, something like that. So if I want to proactively secure my environment, I should be focusing on remediating these recommendations and overall improving my security posture. For instance, on this Kubernetes cluster, this is something we leave intentionally vulnerable. So there's a lot of different actions that can be taken to secure it. As you can see, a lot of different recommendations are present. However, if I'm really trying to hunt those most critical risks throughout my environment, this is not a very effective way to go about doing that. One of our lead security researchers at Microsoft, John Lambert, has a very succinct way of describing why. He says that defenders think in lists, attackers think in graphs, and while this is true, attackers win. And what I take away from that is really that we need to start fundamentally shifting the way we think about our environment and our attack surface if we want to stay ahead of those attackers. For instance, by just targeting these individual recommendations on this resource, I have a pretty narrow view. In reality, our attack surfaces and our environments are all interconnected, the resources share different security relationships with one another, and if we think about our environment as a graph, a breach or an incident at one point in that graph is not necessarily the same, it won't have the same impact as any other point in that graph if it were to happen. That's due to things like where your critical system lives, maybe the presence of PII. But overall, we need to understand how each one of these recommendations fits back into that graph to truly understand the risk that is posing to your environment. And to do that, I can actually proactively search across that graph by using something called Cloud Security Explorer. So we're going to go to that Cloud Security Explorer next. And once I navigate there, I'm effectively allowed to create graph-based queries to target that graph that lives at the heart of Defender for Cloud. So walking through a very basic example, you can see that I can build a query to target virtual machines in my environment that are exposed to the internet. If I was hunting risk across those virtual machines, maybe I'd want to understand what sort of vulnerabilities are on those, in which case I can add another filter to add, you know, those virtual machines that have a critical or high vulnerability applied to them. And as I update that, we'll be able to see that there are fewer virtual machines in my environment that meet that criteria. So it's a simple example, but you can see that even just adding in a couple of risk factors helps reduce the scope of what we need to be targeting. So while those two risk factors are a relatively straightforward example, Defender for Cloud comes pre-built with many different of these templates for the Cloud Security Explorer. For instance, we're now looking at another one which is targeting container images that have been pushed by a particular code repository that has vulnerabilities that are at least of critical and that are used to create active Kubernetes workloads in my environment or running active Kubernetes workloads in my environment. So this is something that I understand. So this is something that I understand. I would need a lot of focus and attention to, instead of going to my application teams and asking them to simply fix all the vulnerabilities that live in their container images, I'm able to go to them with a very targeted list of which ones are actually posing the most risk to my organization. So while this Cloud Security Explorer is great for proactively hunting for things that are specific to my organization, at the end of the day, if I am somehow, you know, critically at risk to something in my environment, if there is a path that an attacker could take to attack my environment or exploit it, I want Defender for Cloud to be automatically giving me that information. I don't want to have to go out and proactively hunt for that. And that's exactly why we have something called the attack path analysis. For this attack path analysis, we can take an example to understand what I mean. So for this particular one, we see that an internet-exposed Azure VM with high-severity vulnerabilities allows lateral movement to a critical Azure storage account with sensitive data. From a risk perspective, you can understand how valuable this information is to have versus just that I have vulnerabilities on a particular VM. I could have 100 different VMs in my environment that all have the same exact vulnerability, but if 99 of them are internal only, don't meet the conditions for that lateral movement, or maybe aren't connected to the storage account that has sensitive information, I might not need to prioritize any of those in my environment versus this one, which is really posing a critical risk. However, getting all of that information and really understanding all of these different risk factors around this VM is very, very difficult unless we are thinking about risk from this graph perspective. So that's why attack path analysis can be so valuable. It really helps me cut through a lot of the noise and a lot of those recommendations and uses these risk factors to help me understand where do I need to prioritize the limited time I have to reduce the greatest risk in my environment. So now that we've taken a look into how Defender for Cloud can be used proactively to secure our environment, I now want to look at how we can use it to reactively secure our environment. So instead of looking at recommendations, which are instances of where Defender for Cloud has identified risk, I want to be looking at security alerts. So much like how a recommendation is an instance where Defender for Cloud has identified some type of risk in my environment, a security alert is effectively an instance where Defender for Cloud has identified some type of suspicious or malicious activity. So if I am a SOC analyst or, you know, on an incident response team and I'm trying to understand what exactly is going on in my environment, I want to be reviewing these security alerts to truly understand what type of activity is taking place. So in reviewing the security alerts, I'm going to click into one of these to understand what sort of telemetry Defender for Cloud is giving me on this particular activity. We'll keep with the trend of looking at different threats to my container's environment, and we can see here that this alert is going to contain a lot of that information that someone triaging would need to have. So alert severity, related entities, related evidence, what was the suspicious process, etc. There's also going to be a take action tab. Pause. This tab is going to help me understand how I can start to actually take action on whatever security alert this is, whether that's, you know, reviewing relevant logs, actually taking steps to mitigate the threat, or by proactively preventing future attacks from happening by maybe proactively addressing some of those recommendations. Now, this is going to give me the information I need to really start taking my investigation to the next level and responding to it. So this is all great information. But one of my concerns is that I am only looking at an individual security alert that may only be telling me part of the overall story. If I want a holistic view into all the activities happening in my environment and to really be able to understand if an attack is happening, I need to be correlating these alerts together and looking at related alerts that might be part of the same incident. Play. And that's exactly why we've started to integrate Defender for Cloud data and telemetry into the Defender XDR portal. So we're actually going to navigate to that portal now. And within that portal, we have the concept of what we call an incident. So we're going to see what I mean by that. We're going to first start out by going to the security alerts. And these are all of the same security alerts that we were just reviewing in the Defender for Cloud portal. So you can see that I'm filtered right now on only those alerts. So these are the same exact alerts coming from Defender for containers, Defender for servers, et cetera. And now they're all available in the XDR portal. This really helps me with two things. First, it's going to help me reduce portal fatigue. If I'm already triaging my alerts here from things like endpoint, identity, and office, why would I need to go to another portal to also triage my cloud security alerts when realistically, cloud security is part of our overall security operations strategy? So getting all this telemetry into this Defender XDR portal really reduces the amount of fatigue and the amount of portals I need to go to. In addition, it also helps me correlate these alerts together that may be related and be able to take a step back and look at a broader attack instead of just honing in on an individual alert. So to illustrate what I mean by that, we're going to click into one of these Kubernetes events deleted alerts. So very similar to what it was like in Defender for Cloud, that portal, we're going to see a lot of the basic information I would need to start triaging what's going on. However, notice at the top of the screen, we see part of incident hands-on keyboard attack was launched from a compromised account. So that's telling me that this is part of a wider incident. And while that individual alert may be low fidelity, it's connected to a wider attack that could definitely be something more malicious in my environment. So we can see right here as we scroll through all of these alerts that are connected to this incident that something much more malicious is actually happening in my environment. Pause. I see things like log scanning tools being detected, Mimikatz being dropped, even RDP attempts to my domain controllers, and down at the bottom, those Kubernetes events deleted as well. So now I know, now that I'm not looking at that individual alert, I know that something very serious is going on in my environment, and I should take steps to go out and actually stop that threat from happening. If I'm not using something like Security Copilot to help me understand how I can start taking action to respond to this threat, what I can do is go into the threat analytics report that's available within Defender XDR. So this threat intelligence report is effectively going to use all of Microsoft's very deep threat intelligence to help inform me as to what's going on with this particular attack. Because we came here from a container-related attack, we're specifically looking at Kubernetes-related threat intelligence information. So how do attackers go about attacking Kubernetes environment? What are the recommended actions I can take to start remediating Kubernetes threats? So now that I've, you know, read that threat analytics report, I feel a little bit more confident that I know how to start responding to this attack. And I know that one of the first things I should do is start to contain it from spreading anymore. One of the things I want to do there is head to our evidence and response section where I can take advantage of some new responses that Defender for Cloud has. Play. So if I go into this section here, this is going to be where I typically can review all sorts of different files and evidence related to the attack. But with some of our new capabilities we've included, you can now see we include Kubernetes pods here on the left. And what this allows me to do is actually take response actions on those Kubernetes pods that seem to be involved at the heart of this attack. So if I want to either terminate this pod altogether and remove it, or I can also isolate the pod and simply cut it off from the network while I continue to investigate it, and it would only be allowed to communicate with Defender for Cloud. So again, if I'm trying to contain this attack and stop it, this is going to be one of the first things I want to do to make sure it's not spreading to anywhere else. So now that I've done that, one of the things that I'm going to want to do after I contain it is continue to do some advanced hunting and truly understand the true scope of the impact in my environment. While reviewing all those security alerts is fantastic, I may want to build out some of my own advanced threat hunting queries to target particular events happening in my cloud environment. For that, we've started to include cloud audit and cloud process events in the Defender XDR hunting table. So this means that my analyst can now get even more visibility into my cloud environment and understand more of what's actually happening there. So overall, these are some of the ways that Defender for Cloud can be used to reactively respond to our environment. You can see that by integrating a lot of this data into the Defender XDR portal, we're now able to really contextualize all of this great Defender for Cloud telemetry with the rest of the signal telemetry as part of the security.microsoft.com portal. Thank you very much for the time today. I hope you enjoyed learning a little bit about Defender for Cloud. Of course, there's a lot more to learn than what I can explain in 15 minutes, so please feel free to check out the link on this page to learn even more about it. Outside of that, thank you very much for your time.